lineup of sessions today. We'll start with a couple of talks by Professor Vidyasagar and Dr. S.P. Arun from IISc, who brings a unique perspective too. And for the remaining part of the day today, we have our PhD students who joined in our first batch presenting their research. We are a young department, so we don't have very senior PhD students at this time. So we have the students who joined us in the first batch sharing their research. Then Dr. Simona kindly agreed to talk about scientific communication and writing skills. That's going to follow the AI students' presentation. And then a talk by Professor Rajalakshmi. And finally, we conclude with the last session on an Ask Me Anything, an AMA panel on research where PhD students can ask any questions they want of faculty. Often, especially in the current virtual times, PhD students find it difficult to just have informal chats where they express their concerns. And PhD especially can be a difficult time when you're alone. So hopefully the last session today will help some of you at least ask questions and have informal chats on concerns and any general questions you want going forward. So that's about the session today, and hopefully we'll have many more of these sessions with more research works coming out of the department in strong venues, and maybe they can be showcased here in the years to come. But with this short introduction, once again, I welcome all of you here. And over to Bhatt again. Bhatt, would you like to introduce Professor Vidyasagar before we start?
Professor Vidyasagar has been a visionary in the world of AI. And he is a distinguished professor at the IIT Hyderabad, but he has been awarded the Fellow of Royal Society and a former director of Center for AI, DRDO, in the 80s. And over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. I chose this title, Perspectives on Deep Learning and Reinforcement Learning. As Professor Vinit said, I hope this is just the first of many such days, and I eagerly look forward to future days. So here's a quick outline of the talk. Essentially three major parts: perspectives on AI and ML, perspective on DL, perspectives on RL, and then just a few slides on challenges for the future. So let me start with what do I mean by AI and machine learning, because you see that in this field people are using these words without necessarily defining them, and that leads to a lot of confusion. So my definition of artificial intelligence is that it is the technology of enabling computers to perform tasks that had previously been difficult for machines, though very easy for human beings. So AI does not include numerical computation, because obviously machines are way better at it than we are. If you ask a machine to invert 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, it can do it and we can't do it. But things like image and speech recognition, playing games, and heuristic reasoning as opposed to strictly logical reasoning, these are all examples of AI. I will not talk about heuristic reasoning in today's lecture because of time limitation, but historically that was one of the first topics studied under AI. So next thing is, you may say, well, all right, if this is AI, then what is machine learning? So my definition is, machine learning is a set of tools or algorithms that enables a computer to realize AI. So in the way I use these words, and I'm fairly consistent, AI is the destination, that's the objective. We want the machine to replicate human abilities, but that's just a lofty goal. We don't know how to get there. Whereas machine learning is the path that takes you towards that destination. I have to close with this caution, because my terminology is not at all standard. Many people tend to use AI and ML kind of interchangeably, or that ML is a subset of AI, all kinds of complications are there. But my definition has at least the advantage that it is quite precise. Let me talk something about a little more precise definition of AI. And in particular, I want to make a distinction between what I call functional AI versus operational AI. Remember, I defined AI as getting a computer to mimic human abilities, but that's a very vague description. It turns out you have to actually distinguish between functional similarity, which means that a machine simply replicates the functionalities of a human being, but at an input-output level, and much more stringent requirement is called operational similarity. which is that the machine not only replicates the functionalities, but also achieves them in the same way that a human being would. Now, this was not clearly understood in the early days of AI, and in fact, even later. So let me give a couple of examples. When you go back to the middle of the 19th century, when industrial automation first took off, people were trying to replicate human labor by machines. So now suppose you wanted to replace a horse, or in India, a bull that was pulling a plow, okay? So how would you do that? Well, if you want to build a functional mechanical horse, the only thing you care is does it pull the plow or not? You don't care how it does it. Whereas an operational mechanical horse would have four legs. Okay. Similarly, if you wanted to build a functional airplane, all you really want to do is to build a machine that can get off the ground and fly, whereas an operational airplane would actually flap its wings the way that a bird would. Now, the key point is that when societies around the world started automating, they focused entirely on functional similarity and didn't bother in the least bit whether the solutions had any operational similarity to humans and animals. Now, why is this important? This, in the early days of AI, there was massive confusion about this. So the phrase AI was coined by John McCarthy in 1955, but the idea of machine intelligence predated that by quite a few years. Alan Turing, who is of course well known for the Turing test, he wrote a paper trying to define what he called machine intelligence. And he said that a machine is intelligent if it can fool a human being into thinking that he is interacting with another human and not a machine during an interactive session. Okay? So what it means is you as a human walk into a room and there's a curtain, and behind the curtain there is either a computer, sorry, either a machine or another human being, and you have to guess which is which. Obviously, in applying the Turing test, there are some limitations on the type of questions to be asked. So if you ask the entity on the other side of the curtain to multiply, let us say, two 20-digit numbers and the answer comes back instantly, then you know that there's a machine and not a human. So the Turing test has to be applied with some amount of discretion. Okay. By the way, here's a little bit of trivia. When Turing used the word computer, he did not mean the machine. He meant the person using the machine. Look it up if you don't believe me. So somewhere along the way, the word computer changed its meaning from the user of the machine to the machine itself. Just a bit of trivia. Now, about 30 years later, there was a philosopher called John Searle, and he basically rejected Turing's test of machine intelligence. And he said that, look, suppose there's a computer, it can translate English into Chinese and backwards and reverse, and it can fool a set of native Chinese speakers by doing this translation very fast, which of course in 1980 was impossible. But he said, okay, let's assume that such a thing exists. Is it intelligent? And Searle said, no, I don't think so, because it doesn't understand Chinese. It's just doing a bunch of mechanical operation, and it doesn't even have a consciousness. So he strengthened Turing's machine intelligence test to something that he called strong AI, building a machine with understanding and consciousness. Now, if you use my terminology of functional versus operational AI, you can see that this particular discussion is kind of pointless. Turing wants functional AI and Searle wants operational AI. Okay, that's all it is. Now, interesting point is, I told you that during the early days, industrial automation focused solely on functional similarity. But in contrast with that, many of the early researchers in AI focused a great deal on operational similarity. So they had the idea that, okay, let's try to understand how humans do something. And if you can catch that in a machine, then we'll achieve human level functionality. So for example, in the field of computer vision, people like David Marr, I didn't put the name here, he did a lot of work on how do humans process images. and he came out with this concept of multiple layers of vision, low level, mid level, high level vision. And they were trying to mimic human vision. People who were trying to do language processing, they came out with these grammars, syntactic grammars, contextual grammars, context-free grammars, again trying to replicate humans. In speech processing in the late 1970s, there was a group in IBM, Yorktown Heights. They proposed this mathematical model called hidden Markov models. And that was again based on how humans process speech. Then in the late 80s and early 90s, there were these things called artificial neural networks, which were supposed to replicate the human, I'm sorry, the word brain is missing right there, replicate the human brain using these artificial neurons. And even later in the 90s, when IBM built a Deep Blue machine to play the then world champion Garry Kasparov, they programmed this computer by talking to a human grandmaster called Joel Benjamin and said, okay, how do you play chess? Got a bunch of information from him and used that to program his machine. Now, why am I going on at great length about these points? The point is that from about 2000 onwards, nobody in the AI world has paid any more attention to operational AI. They're not at all bothered about how humans do something. They're perfectly happy if they can build a computer system that can replicate human functionalities, okay? But it is important to know that there do exist two different types of AI, and one of these days operational AI may make a comeback. We can't rule it out. So in contemporary machine learning, there's a fairly sharp distinction between deep learning, which I call DL, and reinforcement learning, which I call RL. The application domains are very different. The mathematical formulations are very different, and the levels of mathematical maturity are also very different. So I'm dividing the rest of my talk into two distinct parts. So let's start with deep learning. So obviously, you can't have something called deep learning unless there is something called shallow learning. Again, this is another phrase that I created, not everybody uses it. You can think about shallow learning or neural network learning before deep learning, okay? So what is it? Well, in the mid-1980s, people invented these things called multilayer perceptron networks. This word perceptron is a bit misleading, because this is the architecture of a multilayer network. You have a bunch of inputs, in this case five, and each of them feeds into each of these summing junctions by some weight. I did not put the weight on these arrows, just to reduce clutter in this picture. But these are not unweighted edges, they're weighted edges. So X1 times W11 is what shows up here. X5 into W15 is what shows up there. All of these are added into a summing junction that goes through this function box, which I call F1. And it goes to the next level summing junction, which goes through its own neurons. Finally, one last final junction, final summing junction, one last neuron characteristic, and you get an output. So for historical reasons, these multilayer networks always have a scalar output, even though the input is a vector. Each of these boxes, F1 through F9, they're all neurons, and they don't all have to be the same. So some of the common neurons, well, starting with the original neural element, which is called the perceptron, introduced by Frank Rosenblatt. What it did was to take a weighted sum of the inputs, compared against a threshold, which I called as theta, called that as Z. If Z is positive, it output 1, and Z is negative, it output minus 1. If Z is 0, you assign that or that at random, it doesn't really matter. And you can also change minus 1 to 0, it also doesn't matter. Then later in the mid-80s, 90s, 2000s, the popular characteristic was called the sigmoid, which as you can see, unlike the perceptron, which is a discontinuous function, right there, the sigmoid is not only continuous, but in fact it is infinitely differentiable. So this is the hyperbolic tangent, for example. That's a very common neuron characteristic. In the last 10 years or so, people have been looking at a whole bunch of other characteristics. One of them I showed called the rectified linear unit. There are lots of others, but this is a typical example. And this is an example of what is called a P piecewise linear characteristic. So one of the reasons why people use these multilayer networks, which I'll continue to call multilayer perceptron networks, even though the neural element doesn't have to be a perceptron. But the reason why people use them is this thing called the universal approximation property. So every one of these neuron characteristics, except for the pure perceptron, they have what is called the universal approximation property. This work was done in the early 90s by two people, George Sebenko and Kurt Hornick. And what they showed approximately is the following. I'm trying to simplify it to avoid making very complicated statement. Suppose you have a continuous function f. It maps n-dimensional inputs into scalar output. You can approximate this function f to an arbitrarily small accuracy epsilon over an arbitrarily large but compact set of inputs x. That means norm of x is smaller than some number m, by using a sufficiently large number of neurons. And it turns out, for this theorem to work, you don't even need hidden layer neurons. Just a flat one layer neural network is good enough. So this was a nice theoretical advance, but it left open the following questions. So how many neurons do you need? So as you squeeze the accuracy towards zero, and as you increase the size m towards infinity, how fast does the number of neurons grow? Does one neural characteristic, for example, a sigmoid, offer an advantage over another one, like a ReLU, for example? And third, how about the architecture? As I told you, the original proofs of Sebenko and Hordick, they did not even require hidden layer neuron. Just a flat architecture was fine. But do you gain anything by having multi-layer neural network? So all these questions have been pretty much answered over the last 10, 12 years. I would like to suggest that you look at papers by René Vidal, who's at Johns Hopkins, and Benjamin Reck, who's at Berkeley. And I said the answers are suggestive but not definitive. What I mean by this is, these three questions are a bit too vague to state very universal solution. So what these people and others like them did was to look at very restricted situations and then answer them very precisely. And then it's up to individuals like us to extrapolate their answer to more general situation. But to summarize very quickly, what René showed is that ReLU seem to be better than other types of neurons, primarily because of the piecewise linear characteristic. And what Benjamin Rex showed is that if you take the same number of neurons and arrange them in a hierarchical fashion as opposed to a flat fashion, it seems to improve the representational ability. Okay. I should have put seems, but then I thought, okay, you will read it for yourself. Now, let me come to one of the most important reasons why we use neural networks. How do you use neural networks? There are a bunch of labeled inputs, which I'll call XI and YI. XI are the training inputs, Y sub I are the labels, and there are M of them. And the inputs themselves are vectors, so I indicate this by boldface. And the label is invariably just a scalar, so I indicate that by italic scale. Now, if your neural network can faithfully reproduce this training data, that's fine, but nobody gives you any marks for that. What you really want the neural network to do is, now you show the neural network a new test input, and I'm sorry, that should be a bold face, just like that. Okay. So now you show the neural network a new unlabeled test input. So there is a right answer, except the network doesn't know it. So what you want to know is, can the neural network reproduce the correct label? If so, this is called generalization. And that's what you want. You don't care all that much about reproducing the known answers, but to guess the unknown answer. Now, already by the time of the early 1990s, this fact was proven in a very precise way. That is, if you train any kind of a neural network and a finite number of training samples, you cannot get perfect generalization. That means you cannot always get the correct label for a previously unseen test input. And this is true whether the label is binary, in which case it is called a classification problem, or if the label is a real number, in which case it's called a regression problem. In neither case can you get the right answer perfectly on every test input after only a finite amount of training. The best that one can hope is that the trained neural network gives more or less the right answer most of the time. And this has been captured in an acronym called PAC, probably approximately correct learning theory. This is a bit of a mouthful, so some people actually call it statistical learning theory. And the point is that you can make very precise statements about what situations can be learned, how fast does a network learn to generalize, and so forth. So there are two relevant numbers here. Those of you who might have taken courses from Professor Sumohana or may take in the future will recognize these phrases. For a regression, for the classification problem, the relevant index is called Wapnick-Chevenin increase or VC dimension. And for regression problems where you're trying to guess a real number, the VC dimension is replaced by something called the Pollard dimension. This is the second edition of a book I wrote in 2003. The first edition is out of print, but it is subsumed on this one. This is still pretty much a state-of-the-art book for PAC learning. Okay, so now let me talk about deep learning. Until now, we talked about relatively shallow network, maybe a few hundred neurons at best, 2, 3, 4, 5 hidden layers. But what happened is that the idea of going way beyond that was proposed in 2012. There was a huge database of about 14 million images called the ImageNet Challenge. And actually, the ImageNet is the database. The challenge is called the Large Scale Visual Recognition Challenge. And typically, people were getting 30-25% error. Then in 2012, under the guidance of Professor Jeff Hinton, these three Russian students, Salakhudinov, Krishevsky, and Suchkever, they proposed a deep convolutional neural network using GPU. Now this A stands for Alexander. So people have informally been referring to this network as the AlexNet. And what they did was they achieved a huge reduction in the error rate in one shot. So the if you can see in 2010, the error rate was about 28%. In 2011, it was 26%. And these people brought it down from 27-26% to 16% in one shot. And then, of course, future researchers did even better. And as I mentioned, now the error rates are as low as about 2%. But these are huge networks. They use hundreds of millions of adjustable parameters and hundreds, if not thousands, of hidden layer neurons. Okay? Now, there have been other applications like conversion of text between languages, speech synthesis, interactive voice recognition system. The performance in these domains is less impressive than in image processing. You surely do not get 2% error rate, I can tell you that. But, okay, now, here comes a little more controversial part of the talk. What are the theoretical foundations of deep learning? Are there any theoretical foundations? Can we say that DL is just a bunch of examples and no theory? Well, my view is almost. There are lots of questions, but very few answers. And I'll show you, in the next few slides, some questions and some possible answers. Now, what do you do in a neural network? You adjust the weights so as to minimize the least squares error between the desired output and the actual output, summed over all the training inputs. Now this is a highly non-convex cost function. Therefore, it should have an enormous number of local minima. And yet, the deep learning neural network don't seem to get stuck in these local minima. Why is that? So people like Professor Chaim Sompolinsky, a very well-known and elderly gentleman, if I'm not mistaken, Professor Sam Polinsky should be around 80 now. He's even older than I am. And he was an expert in spin glass physics. And his idea, that is Professor Sam Polinsky's ideas, have been followed up by Sanjeev Arora, who's a prof at Princeton. And basically their idea is the following. Yes, there are lots of local minima, but they are all symmetric. And symmetries are actually beneficial. So for example, if you look at this particular multilayer network, what are the symmetries? Well, if I change all of these weights to those weights, and I change all of these weights to those weights, is the network any different? No, it's just the same network. It's just like you interchange this neuron with that neuron. So you have, I showed you here, five different neurons. Suppose you permute them. How many permutations are there? You can see two, five factorial. You can do the same at the second level and at the third level. So the point is that the input-output map of this multilayer network is invariant under the permutations of weights. So that means the local minima are all the same. They look like multiple local minima, but if you look at them carefully, they're just permutations of each other. That's basically what Professor Sam Polinsky's argument was. And the other argument that he could show was that all these local minima are shallow. What that means is the difference between the local minimum and the global minimum of the least squares error cost function is very, very small. That means you pay very little penalty for getting stuck in a local minimum. So I'm going to skip the next two slides. One is on reducing the number of neurons without sacrificing performance. And the next one is L1 regularization. So that is, in addition to minimizing the cost function, which is this quadratic error, if you take some weight, that's the L1 norm of the weight, not the L2 norm, but the square, but the sum of the absolute value. This seems to have a tendency of forcing a lot of the weights to equal zero. You can prove this formally in linear problems. That means where f is a linear function of w and f. So people could use it in deep learning, but it doesn't seem to be very widely used. Okay, now let me spend the last 15 minutes or so talking about reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning is built on the foundation of what is called Markov decision processes. And MDPs are sequential decision making. But where the underlying probabilistic model is known, and reinforcement learning can be thought of as MDP with unknown probabilistic model. So a lot of the excitement about AI actually comes from reinforcement learning. Two of them I'll mention. One is game playing, like AlphaZero and so forth. And it uses an algorithm called Monte Carlo tree search and autonomous navigation. For example, Professor Rajalakshmi is going to talk a bit later. She has received funding for a large test bed for autonomous navigation. And one of the things that people can do in autonomous navigation is to use reinforcement learning to avoid obstacles. Okay, so what is a Markov decision process? I'm just going to assume everybody knows what a Markov process is. That it's a process where the conditional probability of the next state, given all the past state, is the same as the conditional probability of the next state, given only the most immediately previous state. If this is always true, it is called a Markov process. So take, for example, the snakes and ladders game, okay? I'm going to spend a minute on this thing. Suppose you're in square number 61, and you throw a four-sided die, okay? And all four outcomes are equally probable. So if you throw a one, you move there, and then you go back to square 19. If you throw a two, you go there, and so you go up to square 81. If you throw a three, you go there, and you go back to square 60. If you throw a four, you just stay there, because square 65 has neither a snake nor a ladder. The key point, of course, is what happens after you reach square 61 doesn't in the least bit depend on how you got to square 61. That's what makes this a Markov process, okay? Now, the idea of a Markov reward process is there is a reward which is associated with each state. So what you do is, now remember the states are random, so you take the expected value of the reward at future times conditioned on the initial state, and then you discount the future rewards with some discount factor gamma. And because gamma is less than one, this infinite series will come here. There is no problem. The next one is what is called a Markov decision process. So in the case of a decision process, in addition to the state space, there is also an action space. So each action has its own corresponding state transition matrix. Now, in typical reinforcement learning problems, the number of actions is very small. It can be as small as 2. If you play this game called blackjack, where the aim is to get as close to 21 as you can without going over, you have only 2 choices, either you draw a card or not. So the number of actions is only 2. But the number of states is about 2 to the power of 100, enormous. So the key idea in Markov decision processes is what is called a policy. A policy is just a map that takes states into actions. So if you take this discounted reward, I just realized something, excuse me for a minute. Yeah, this should be R, not V, reward. Okay. So if you take the expected value of the reward with a starting point and a particular policy with the same discount factor, that is called the value of a policy. And the whole point in reinforcement learning is to find the best policy. And there are tools like optimality equation of Bellman, policy iteration that allow us to find the optimal policy. Okay, so I'll skip this slide because lack of time. So now what is reinforcement learning? I have only one slide on that. You can suppose you have a Markov decision process and you don't know the dynamics. What do you do? Well, for a while you just let the system go, observe the state transitions and construct an approximate model. Then you apply the Markov decision process theory to this approximate model. This is known as indirect RL and it's not used very much. But what is commonly used is what is called direct RL. You immediately start taking decision. Even though you don't know anything about your system, but there's a very successful algorithm called Q-learning. It seems to work very well. And it is based on a mathematical technique called stochastic approximation. All right. So I have about 1 minute to cover 3 slides. Okay, let's see what I can do. I think the biggest challenge in deep learning is to get some mathematical foundations for the various approaches used. If the past 40, 50 years of AI teaches anything at all, it is that those approaches based on a solid mathematical foundation endure the passage of time and the rest don't. Of course, not everybody would agree. This is my particular personal opinion. How about in reinforcement learning? So just now, people are talking about the notion of approximately optimal because the real problems are too large to be solved precisely. And there are also issues of storage and CPU speed. So just writing down a formula on a sheet of paper doesn't help you. Implementation details are very important. This is what I'm most excited about. Most theorems in reinforcement learning are asymptotic in nature. They tell you what happens as you take more and more samples. But there's a new and very exciting area called finite time stochastic approximation that tells you how far you are from the solution after a finite number of steps, let's say 1,000, 10,000, whatever. And this was exactly the motivation of my earlier book on packed learning theory. So I'm looking for connections between these two subjects. And the point, of course, is that this is, again, a very interesting area. Most reinforcement learning algorithms do not cater for starting over. You start at an initial state, you keep fine-tuning the policy, and that's all. But when you talk about teaching a computer to play chess, what happens if the computer program loses? It starts all over again. Similarly, in autonomous navigation, if you have one algorithm for programming your vehicle, it goes and crashes into a barrier, what do? You drag it back to the starting point and make it go again. So all these kinds of applications make heavy use of starting over. So as of now, there is very little theory for these kinds of situations. So that's all I had to say. I hope you sort of understood it. I finished exactly on time. And can I, are there any questions? But I don't even know where to see the questions.
There haven't been any questions, so we'll open the floor. Anybody can directly ask the question.
Okay, all right. If anybody wants to ask any questions, please feel free. I there were 2-3 typos I saw, fortunately not very many. So I will fix the typos and share it with the organizers. Okay, so I'll stop sharing now. And
This is Vineet here, Professor Sagar.
Tell me.
Thank you again for the talk. Very interesting. I had one question to ask you from a broader sense. I mean, you talked about bringing seemingly different perspectives of deep learning and reinforcement learning together.
Mm-hmm.
But the different directions of AI over history has been connectionist versus symbolic AI. So in a sense, all DL, RL are all in the connectionist space. So I wanted to check about what your thoughts are about the role of connectionists, like AI. Is there no role at all? Are they coming together at this time? And at least the perspective that I asked this is, there's this recent stress towards automated reasoning, explaining things like that. Do you see a reason for these two to come together?
No, not an excellent question. This is where the limitations of 40 minutes comes into the picture. So in fact, the very, very first applications were symbolic, okay? Automated reasoning, fault tolerance, fault detection, troubleshooting. What people found is that the computational complexity of those algorithms grows too fast. So while it's very beautiful mathematics, the size of problems that you can solve with those approaches is noticeably less than what you can solve with purely numerical methods like what I have shown. But of course, with the advances in computation, even symbolic computations will become far more feasible. And there is somebody question from Mohan. How much of operational realism is required in the experiment to become a simulator? Well, that's the whole point, isn't it? The field of AI has moved totally away from operational realism. So in other words, I gave the example of low-level vision. People felt that if you can figure out how the eyes see, we can build a machine that can see. And now people figured out that, man, that is not very important at all. So I don't really think that AI is going to circle back to operational similarity, because there has been so much success by abandoning operational similarity and sticking only to functional similarity. So having tasted success, I don't see what would cause the community to go back. So since I have 1 minute, I'll go back to what Dr. Vineet said. You see, the symbolic representations are much more powerful at a philosophical level. Even if they are not necessarily more powerful at a computational level because of storage and data limitations, at a conceptual and symbolic level, they are much more powerful and probably much more representative of human thought. Okay. So I don't think we should ever stop striving for the connectionist paradigm. Okay. But right now, because of the sheer size of the problems involved, the deep and reinforcement learning approaches based on pure computational approaches seem to be ruling the day. But who knows? Eventually, the pendulum may swing back the other way as well.
Got it. Thank you.
All right. Well, if there are no more questions, thank you very much.